So sorry, the audio was on mute. So we were discussing. So last class we were discussing the topic absorption costing and variable costing. So in this today we will be discussing joint products and by products. So this is and we will be discussing the problems from the section thereafter. So we are going to discuss the various method used in allocation of the joint product cost and by product cost to those products. So these are the topics that we are going to deal today. So is the audio clear? Can you hear me? Okay. So let's continue. So joint products and by products, we are providing an overview for the joint products and what are by products. So joint products are those products which comes out of a joint production process. So when two or more products are produced from the same joint or same production process or a joint production process, those two or more products are called joint products. So here, when two or more products are produced from the same basic raw material and they are of almost equal in value, those products are known as joint product. And we are providing with an example of petrol and diesel. They are joint products which comes out of a joint production process of refining of this crude oil. When crude oil is refined, this is a joint production process. After completion of this production process, we get two products, which is petroleum and diesel. This petroleum and diesel is a joint product. And by product means they are incidental products. When we are producing a main product, certain incidental products may arise. So those products are called by products, which as the result of that production process, but which is not the main product that we are intended to produce. So the example of a by product is because when sugarcane is produced, we get both sugar and molasses. So the main component that we are going to produce is the sugar, but molasses is a byproduct which are incidental to the production process. So in main products, joint products, the sales value we are providing with the comparison of the sales value of the main product and the byproduct. The sales value of the main product would be high in case of processing of the sugarcane. The sugar will be of high sales value, but the molasses that we obtain after the processing of the sugarcane will be of low sales value. And these molasses will be the result of the processing of the sugarcane. And this is incidental product, hence it is a byproduct, and it will be having low sales value. So this is the overview for the joint product and byproduct. So let's discuss this joint product and byproduct in detail. So joint product are two or more products produced simultaneously by the same person. By undertaking a joint production process or a common production process, we may be getting two or more products. Those products are called joint products. So this when at a point this product gets separated into two or more products, like at the end of a production process, these products get split into different types of products. So that point where the joint products become separate and they will be distinctively identifiable from each other, that particular point is called a split-off point. And here we have provided an example like a joint product like butter, cheese, cream from the milk, and fuel oil, gasoline, and kerosene from the crude oil. They are separably identifiable and they will be incurring undifferentiated joint costs until they reach this split-off point. In processing of this milk, the processing of the milk would be a joint production process. After the processing is complete, we will be getting butter, cheese, and cream from the milk. They are distinctively identifiable products and be having separate existence. And when the crude oil is refined, we will be getting fuel oil, gasoline, kerosene from this crude oil. So these products will be separately identifiable and they incur a joint cost. They will be separated as a result of a joint production process. So while in the joint production process, they will be incurring certain costs. So these joint costs may be undifferentiable among these products until they reach this split-off point. So this is the joint products split-off point. And joint split-off point means where at the split-off point is the point at which these joint products become separate and distinctively identifiable from each other. That particular point is the split-off point. And at the split-off point, we will be getting two more products. Those products are the joint products. Till split-off point, that products may be incurring a common production process, which is called joint production process. So are you clear with this joint product, split-off point, joint production process? So next is what is joint costing? Joint costing means joint cost means we will be having a joint production process in processing a number of products. So during this joint production process or production process, we may be incurring certain costs, which may include material cost, conversion cost, or maybe overheads, everything which in the joint production process. These joint production during this the cost incurred during this joint production process must be allocated to those products which are separated at this split-off point. So the cost which is incurred at the joint production process is called this joint cost. Here we are provided with a diagram. Here this is the joint cost, and at the split-off point, this get into separated into product A and product B. After this, this product get into separated, they may be incurring separable cost for further processing, etc. So this is the split-off point. Split-off point means at the point at which these two products gets separated, and before the split-off point, the joint production process will be undertaken, and the cost incurred during this joint production process will be termed as joint cost. So what is separable cost? Separable costs are the costs that are incurred beyond the split-off point. After the split-off point, the product get into products gets products, two or more products will be formed, and they will be separatively identifiable and distinctively differentiated between the among them. So after the cost incurred after this split-off point will be called as separable cost. And joint cost, what are comprises in the joint cost? Joint costs are the costs which is incurred in the joint production process. So it may be comprising of raw material, labor cost, and overhead cost incurred till this split-off point. All these costs will be included in the joint cost. So joint cost equals raw material cost, direct labor cost, and overhead cost incurred till the split-off point. All these costs incurred till the split-off point will be included in the joint cost. And okay, we know that joint cost allocation is much less useful for cost control and managerial decision making, because these are not differentiable cost. Whether we produce product A or product B or product C from a particular joint production process, this joint production cost will be incurred. So this is a sunk cost, which is irreversible cost. So there will be no relevance in decision making process. There will be no usefulness for cost control. So joint cost allocation is much less useful for cost control purposes and managerial decision making, because they are sunk cost, which is irreversible. Whether they decides production of a particular product or not, you will be incurring this joint production process. They are not differentiable, or they are not differential cost. They will not differ between the various alternatives. So they are irreversible cost, or they are unavoidable cost. For that reason, they will be not useful in the managerial decision-making purposes. So separable costs, we have already discussed those costs which we incurred after the split-off point, and they can be easily traced to this individual product. But joint costs, we cannot easily trace to this individual products. We need to allocate this joint cost to those individual products in order to determine the total cost of production. Okay, then we will be discussing the various methods that we use to allocate the joint production cost to the joint product. So we know that this joint production cost or joint cost will be incurred in the production of the two or more different types of products, and we could not specifically identify a particular amount of cost to the production of those products. So in order to determine the total cost of producing a particular product, we need to allocate some part of the joint cost to the each and individual product. So in order to allocate this cost to joint products, we will be applying various methods. So these methods are going to be dealt later. And the first method is relative sales value at split-off method. And the second method is estimated net realizable value method. And the third method, physical measure and average cost methods. And the fourth one, constant gross profit or gross margin percentage method. So once more, relative sales value at split-off method, estimated net realizable value method, physical measure and average cost method, constant gross profit or gross margin percentage method. So these are the four methods that we use in allocating joint production cost to joint products. Okay, next we are going to deal each and every method in detail. first method, relative sales value at split off method. So this can also be called gross market value method or just sales method. It's also called gross market value method or just sales method. So how we are going to allocate this joint cost using this relative sales value method? This is going to be it. So under this relative sales value split off method or gross market value method or sales method, the joint cost for the joint products are allocated on the basis of the sales value of each product at the split off point. At the split off point, this particular product may be having a sales value. So we are going to allocate this joint cost, this joint product, based on the sales value of those products at the split off point related to the sales value, total sales value of all joint products. So how we are going to, suppose the product that we are going to allocate cost is product X. So how we are going to allocate sales value of product X at split off divided by total sales value of both joint products at the split off into joint cost. The joint cost incurred is allocated on the basis of this relative sales value of the particular product at the split off method to the total sales value of all joint products. So are you clear with this concept of allocating this cost to the product based on the relative sales value split off method? What is the split off point? Okay. Split off point is, it is the point at which these products get separated into distinctively identifiable products. So it is at the completion of this joint production process. At that point is called a split off point, where these products get split into different types of distinctively identifiable products. As it is in the name, it's a split off point. It gets splitted. Until this joint production process, there will be we could not specifically identify a product. So after the completion of the joint production process, at the split off point, this product gets separated into distinctively identifiable products. So those at that point is called the split off point. So Anju, are you clear with the split off point? So under relative sales value split off method, under this method, the joint costs are allocated on the basis of the sales value of this product at the split off point relative to the total sales value of all joint products at the split off point. Based on this, we will be allocating the joint cost to each and every joint products. And next method that we are going to deal, estimated net realizable value method or NRV method. So what is NRV, net realizable value? So this method is very similar to the relative sales value method, and its allocation also done in the same way as the relative sales value method. But the only difference is that instead of the sales value at the split off point, we would be taking the NRV, net realizable value, for that particular product. So certain product will not be having a sales value at the split off point. You know that the product gets separately identifiable into separately divided into two separately identifiable products, two or more separately identifiable products. But since they would not be having any sales value at the split off point, in that case, we need to further process this product and convert it into another form, and we will need to sell that product. So certain products that do not have split sales value at the split off point, we could not take relative sales value at split off point method to allocate the joint cost. For that reason, we would be taking the estimated net realizable value to allocate the joint cost to this particular process. So what is the estimated NRV? Estimated NRV is equal to the future sales price of the item produced that will be sold in the future. That means the future sales price after the further processing. Sales price after further processing less separable cost that will be incurred after the split off point. So after the split off point, if further processing is done, we will be incurring separable cost. So we need to subtract this separable cost from the sales value after further processing. We could arrive at the estimated net realizable value. So this will be this method is suitable when the product that we are for the product that we need to allocate this joint cost would not be having a sales value at the split off point. In that particular case, we would be applying the estimated net realizable value method in order to allocate the joint cost. And how we are going to allocate this is the same manner as the relative sales value method. Here, the estimated NRV divided by the total estimated NRV of all joint products into joint cost will be the formula that will be applied. Instead of sales value, the split of point and the total sales value of joint products, we would be taking the estimated NRV of a particular product divided by the total estimated NRV of all joint products into joint cost. So this method is very similar to the relative sales value method. The only difference is in here we will be taking estimated NRV, while in relative sales value split off method we will be taking sales value at the split off point to allocate this joint cost. And the next method that we are going to deal is the physical measure method. Physical measure is the name itself. Physical measure. Here the joint cost will be allocated based on this physical measure. What are the physical measures used? It can be weight, volume, or any other physical measure of this joint product. So some common unit of the output. We need to be very careful. The common unit of measurement of the output at the split off point will be used. For example, the product we would be using would need to have common unit of measurement such as pounds, tons, gallons, feet, meters, centimeters, or any other unit of measurement can be, but that unit of measurement need to be common for all the products that we are allocating. So this physical measure method may be also called quantitative unit method. So this is the physical measure method. Here the joint cost is allocated based on this quantitative unit or based on a physical measure, which can be weight, volume, or any other physical measure, and this physical measure need to be common for all the product that we are going to allocate joint cost. So this is physical measure method. So are you clear with this physical measure method, estimation, NRV, and relative sales value? Later on, we will discuss problems from this session that will make more concepts more clear to you. So the next method is average cost method. So this average cost method is same like the physical unit, physical measure method. So while in a physical measure, we would be using this uncompleted form, that means input, output in an uncompleted form. But here in the average cost method, we would be using output in a completed form. Like for example, in physical measure, we could say in quantities of the input may be used. But in average cost method, quantities of the output may be used. So when joint cost need to be allocated, it is used in the situation when the joint cost need to be allocated on the basis of physical units of output in a completed form. So it's same as the physical measure method, but in physical units, we would be using completed, physical units of completed units will be used in this average cost method. But in physical measure method, they need not to be in completed form. So for example, we would be producing a toothpaste. So for example, toothpaste. So the number of toothpaste may be used. So for example, the different tubes of the toothpaste can be used to allocate cost in this physical units measure. But in average cost method, we, for example, 100 toothpaste will be packed in a one box. So a total, there will be 10 boxes. So these boxes would be used as a basis for allocation of cost in this average cost method. But while in physical units measure, we will be using uncompleted form, that will be tubes of toothpaste. Number of tubes may be used or grams of toothpaste may be used. But in average cost method, we would be using the boxes in which the toothpaste is packed. So that is the main difference between the allocation of cost in physical unit measure and average cost method. Both are quantitative units of measurement, but have similarities in some aspects. So are you clear? Okay, so once more, the various method that we use to allocate the joint cost are relative sales value split off method. It can also be called gross market value method. Under this, this joint cost are allocated based on sales value at split off point for the product related to the total sales value of the joint products at the split off point. And in estimated NRV, instead of sales value split off, we will be using the estimated NRV. This is used in the situation where one or more of the products that be under consideration or the joint products under consideration does not have a sales value at the split off point. In such case, we would be taking estimated NRV. And what is estimated NRV? That is the further future sales price of this item produced minus the separable cost incurred after the split off point. We get estimated net realizable value. And the next method is physical measure method. Here the joint cost is allocated, physical measure method and average cost method. Here this joint cost will be allocated based on the physical measures, which may be weight, volume, or any physical measure method, physical measures. In physical measure method, but the common strategy that we need to apply is that those physical loads that we will be using need to be common for all the joint products under consideration. Whether it is physical measure method or average cost method, those units of measurement needs to be common. This is the average cost method. And the next method is constant gross profit margin or gross margin percentage method. So here the joint cost will be allocated based upon a constant gross profit margin. So here it is a reverse process. So in this process, there is a reverse process. So we need to allocate this cost by undergoing various steps. So the first steps in this is already said in the name itself, constant gross profit. The gross profit is taken to be a constant, or it is assumed to be a constant figure. So the first step is calculate the gross margin percentage for the total of both of the joint products to be included in the allocation by subtracting the total joint and total separable cost from the total final sales value and dividing the remainder by the total final sales value. The first step that we need to do is calculate the gross margin percentage for total gross margin percentage. How we could calculate the gross margin? Gross margin is equal to sales less total cost, right? So sales we will get from this. So take the total sales value of all the joint products. If we have having two joint products, like take for example, we'll be having a joint product A and product B. We need to take the total sales value for product A and product B. We need to total it, and from that total sales value, we need to subtract the joint cost, total joint cost, and the total separable cost incurred for both product A and product B. So after subtracting the total cost incurred for both product A and product B, which includes joint cost and separable cost, from the total sales value of product A and B, we will be getting a gross margin percentage. Gross margin. We need to calculate this gross margin percentage. How can we calculate this gross margin percentage? Gross margin percentage is equal to this gross margin divided by the total sales value of both product A and product B. So that is the gross margin percentage. First step is calculation of this gross margin percentage. And the next step, after calculation of this gross margin percentage, we need to calculate the gross profit for each individual product by assuming this constant gross profit margin. So for example, after computation of this, we get the gross profit percentage to be, so for example, 20%. Let it be 20%. So we assume this 20% to be the gross margin percentage for both product A and B. So we are assuming a constant gross profit margin percentage for both A and B. So we need to find this gross margin for both product A and B separately, individually, by taking the total sales value of product A, multiplying it with the gross margin percentage, we will be getting this gross margin. So that likewise, we need to calculate the gross margin for individual products by multiplying with the total gross margin percentage, which we calculated in the step one. And the next step is, we need to subtract this gross profit from the sales value and separable cost from these individual sales products. So we computed gross margin for the individual product. So profit or sales value of product A, the product under consideration is product A and B. From the sales value of product B, we need to subtract this gross margin percentage and the separable cost. So we get a portion of this joint cost, which will be applicable to this product A. Likewise, for product B, we need to subtract this gross margin and the separable cost incurred for product B. We will be getting a portion of this remaining cost. Remaining cost would be the portion of the joint cost which will be allocated to product B. So likewise, we could compute the joint cost which is applicable to product A and product B by assuming a constant gross margin percentage. So once again, the first step is calculating a total gross margin percentage with the tracking total cost of all products from the total sales value for product. So total cost includes both separable cost as well as the joint cost. We get a gross margin, and we need to compute the gross margin percentage, and we assume this gross margin percentage to be constant for all the products under consideration. And next is, we need to find the gross margin for each and every individual product. And in the third step, we need to subtract this gross margin from a particular product and the separable cost incurred for that particular product we get the portion of the joint cost that is applicable to that particular product. Likewise, we will be finding the joint cost applicable to all those products under all joint products under consideration. This is how we define joint cost to be allocated to joint products using constant gross profit margin or constant gross profit percentage method. Is it clear? Okay. So let's continue. So the next, after the joint, this is to be the main topic in the joint products. What are joint products, separable cost, split job, and the various methods of allocating cost to this joint product. So we will be discussing problems from this session later on after completion of this theory concepts. And the next is the byproduct. So as we discussed, byproduct means it is a secondary product or incidental product which would be derived from a manufacturing process. So it's a result of the production of a main product which is incidental to the production of a main product. So it is not a primary product or a service that is being produced. And it is an output from a joint production process which may be minor in quantity, and also the NRV or the sales value of those byproduct would be negligible, or it may be of relatively low sales value when compared to the main product. So these byproducts are deemed as said to have no influence on the reported financial results. So byproduct does not receive any allocations of this joint cost because they are not the actual intended product to be produced, or they are incidental products which are produced by incurring this joint manufacturing process. So this byproduct can be useful. There will be having a market, but this marketability or the sales value would be very negligible or relatively low when compared to the main product. So the main criteria deciding whether a product is a byproduct or a main product is because that product may be arrived as a result of a maybe incidental product, and that may be having low sales value when compared to the main product, and the quantity may be low. These are the main criteria that we use in deciding whether a product is a main product or a byproduct. This is not a main intended product, or they are incidental to the production process. So, how we need to treat the we know that this byproduct will be a result of the manufacturing process. So, some of this cost, like materials and labor, will be incurred in producing this byproduct or incurred in this production of this byproduct. So, we need to how we are going to treat the associated cost and revenues of this byproduct. So, for that reason, for that purpose, we are using two methods, which is production method and sales method. These two methods that we are going to discuss on now. So in this production method, how when production method is applied in treating of the cost of this byproduct, how we are going to allocate this cost to this byproduct? How we are going to treat the associated cost and revenues of this byproduct? When production method is used, this byproduct is inventory and is estimated NRV of that or an estimated net realizable value of this byproduct will be deducted from the joint production cost, and this joint cost will be allocated to the main product. This is how that we treat the costing of byproduct in the production method. Under the production method, this byproduct is inventory, and the NRV of the byproduct may be deducted from the joint cost, and thus the reduced joint cost will be allocated to the main product. Right? And the other method that we use is the sales method. Under the sales method, the byproduct is not inventory. Here, the total of the joint cost will be allocated to the main product, and the byproduct when it is sold at the time of sales, the relative sales value reduces the cost of the main product. Only at the time when this byproduct is sold, the sales value of the NRV or the revenue obtained from the sale of this byproduct will be deducted from the cost of this main product. So these are the main two methods, production method and sales method. And the production method, this byproduct is inventory, but in the sales method, it is not inventory. Inventory in production method means the NRV of the byproduct will be deducted from the joint production cost, and that deducted amount will be used to allocate cost to the main product. But in sales method, no such deduction will be made. The entire joint cost would be allocated to the main product, and when the byproduct is sold, at that time, the realized revenue will be used to reduce the cost of the main product. So these are the main two methods, production method and sales method. These are the various topics that we are going to that we dealt from this joint product and by-product. So once again, joint product and by-product, and what are joint product, what is by-product, and what is picture point, separable cost, joint cost, and how we are going to allocate this joint cost to joint products. Four methods: relative sales value split off method, estimated NRV method, physical measure and average cost method, constant gross profit margin method. And we discussed each and every method in detail. And the by-product, what is by-product, and how we determine whether a product is main product or by-product, and the various methods used in treating the associated cost and revenues of the by-product, production method and sales method. So these are the main topic in this session. Is there any doubt? Is there any doubt? Do you need any clearance? So next, let's move forward to the questions from the session. We will be practicing some questions from the session. Okay, let's discuss some of the problems from the session. Joint cost and by cost, by product costing. Okay, is it clear? Can you see the window? Questions? Are you all there? So let's discuss the first question. Question number one. In joint product costing and analysis, which one of the following cost is relevant when deciding the point at which a product should be sold to maximize profit? So option A, purchase cost of the material required for the joint products. Option B, joint cost to the split off point. Option C, sales salaries for the period when the units were produced. Option D, separable cost after the split off point. So what is the question? In this joint production costing and analysis, which one of the following cost is relevant when deciding at the point at which a product should be sold to maximize profit? So in order to determine at which point this product should be sold, which one among this cost is relevant in our decision-making process? Option D, separable cost after the split off point. Right. So at which point we could sell this product? Either we could sell this product at a split off point, or we could sell it after further processing this product. So whether we need to sell the product at split off point, or we need to sell this product at the after further processing, these are the point we could where we could make sales. In order to determine at which point we need to make sale, the cost that is relevant is a separable cost, because we studied that joint production cost is a sunk cost that is irrelevant. It is common to all the product that we produce, and that does not have any relevance in the decision-making process. It is not relevant to the managerial decision-making process. So the only cost that is relevant in our decision-making is the separable cost that is distinctly identifiable for each and every product, and that is incurred after the split off point method in further processing the same product. So, for example, a product has a split off at the split off point, the product may be having a sales value of 10 rupees, and after further processing, we could sell it for 15 rupees. So we need to identify whether we need to sell this product for 10 rupees at the split off point, or whether we need to further process and sell it for 15 rupees. So how we determine, suppose the separable cost in order to after a split off point, if the product takes a for example, separable cost of 6 rupees is incurred. So what is the incremental revenue that we are getting? 15 minus 10, 5 is the incremental revenue that we are getting. The incremental cost that we are incurring is 6. So the incremental revenue is less than the incremental cost. That means our separable cost is higher than the incremental revenue that we are earning after further processing. So what we decide, the separable cost is higher, so we decide to sell the product at a split off point that will be profitable to us. Suppose the separable cost in the situation may be 3 rupees. Say it is 3 rupees. Our incremental revenue is 5 rupees and the separable cost is 3 rupees. We know that the separable cost is less than our incremental revenue, so we'll be having an incremental profit. So it would be better that we further process the product and sell it at after further processing. So the cost that is relevant is the separable cost after the split off point. Option A, purchase cost of the material required for the joint products. It is included in the joint production cost. What all cost will be included in joint products? Materials, labor, and overhead incurred till the split off point will be included in the joint cost, which is irrelevant. Joint cost split off point, it's already irrelevant. Sales salaries for the period when the units were produced. So when the during the production process, the sales salary incurred will be a non-manufacturing cost that does not have any impact in deciding whether we need to sell this product at this point, at split off point, or after further processing. So the cost that is relevant is the separable cost after the split off point. Are you clear? So let's move on to the next question. Question number two. The principal disadvantage of using the physical quantity method of allocating joint cost is that what is the main disadvantage of using physical quantity method of allocating joint cost? Option A, cost assigned to inventories may have no relationship to value. Option B, physical quantities may be difficult to measure. Option C, additional processing cost affect the allocation base. Option D, joint cost by definition should not be separated on a unit basis. So what would be the answer? Which is the primary or principal disadvantage? Option A, right? cost assigned to inventories may have no relationship value. How we are allocating the cost to this physical quantity measure, it is based upon the quantity, physical unit of measurement. Suppose the physical unit of measurement may be more, but the relative value of that particular product will be less. So we may allocate more of the cost to that particular product based on the physical unit of measure, but when compared to that value, the product will be having less value. Hence, there may be chance that product may be at loss, or they may be having more charge on more chargeable cost to that product. So the cost assigned to these inventories may have no relationship to the value, because the cost is allocated based on the unit of this measurement. Option B, physical quantities may be difficult to measure. It is very easy to measure because these physical quantities can be easily measured. Option C, additional processing cost affects the allocation base. No. Additional processing cost means separable cost. It is not going to affect its joint allocation of the joint production cost. That does not have any role in the allocation of the joint production cost. And joint cost by definition should not be separated on a unit basis. There is no such requirement that, or there is no such rule that this joint cost need not be separated on a unit basis. We can separate this joint cost by unit basis, but there will be certain situations. There may be certain exemption situations where this like there will be no relationship between the value of that particular product and the cost assigned to that particular product, not in all case. So we could not say joint cost by definition should not be separated on a unit basis. So the correct answer is cost assigned to inventories may have no relationship to value. Okay, can you move forward to the next question? Question number three. A manufacturing company uses a joint production process that produces three products at the split of point. Joint production cost during April were $720,000. The company uses the sales value method for allocating joint cost. Production information for April were as follows. So a company will be using a joint production process, and three products will be processed at the split of point, and joint production costs are given to us, and the company is applying the sales value method. Sales value method may be also called relative sales value split of method or gross market value method. So the sales value method is also called relative sales value split of method or gross market value method. This method is used for allocating joint cost. And the product information for April is provided to us. The various three products are R, S, and T, the unit produced and sold, and the sales value split of further processing cost. After further processing, sales value and the further processing cost are provided to us. Assume that all three products are main products and they can be sold at the split of point or processed further, whichever is economically beneficial to the company. What is the total cost of product S in April if joint cost is allocated based on sales value split of point? So we know that this product will be the joint cost will be allocated based on the sales value method, and we find that all these products R, S, T will be having a sales value at the split of point. So without any further looking into the details, we could use this sales value split of method because all these products will be having sales value at the split of. So we could allocate. What is the question? What is the total of the cost of product S in April? So what is total cost? Total cost includes both separable cost as well as the allocation of the joint cost. So we need to find the total cost of product S. What is the joint cost to be allocated? Joint cost which is given in this question is equal to 720,000, and we need to allocate this product based on the sales value at the split of point. What are the three products? RS, T, RS, and T. So what is the sales value at split of method? Sales value at split of point. Sales value split of point. Say sales price at split of For R, it is 100. For S, it is 80. And for T, it is 20. And what is the unit sold during that particular? We need to, what is the unit produced? So production, based on the, we need to allocate this cost to the entire unit that is produced. What is the production? Production is 2500 for R and 5000 for S and 7500 for T. And we need to find the total sales value. What is the total sales value? 2500 into 100, it is going to be 2500 to 50,000. 5000 into 80 is going to be 400,000. And 20 into 7500 is going to be 150,000. So the total sales value, at the split of point is 250,000 plus 150,000. 40,000, 40,000 plus 40,000, 800,000. Total sales 800,000. So we need to allocate. What will be the allocation to S? For S, the allocation would be, what is the joint cost? 720,000. Into what is the relative sales value at split of point for S? It is 400,000 divided by the total sales value is 800,000, which is 720,000 into 400,000 divided by 800,000. This is the total joint cost, joint cost for the product S. And what is the total cost for product S? Total cost for product S includes this joint cost plus separable cost. So what is the joint cost? 360,000 that we computed plus separable cost is provided in the question to 150,000. 360,000 plus 150,000 is going to be 510,000. So the answer that gives this is option C, 510,000. So are you clear with the computation? Here the joint cost that need to be allocated is 720,000 and sales value split off on the particular products are provided to us. We need to find the total sales value. We need to find the joint cost, portion of joint cost allocated to the product S. And the total cost is equal to joint cost plus separable cost, which is provided to us. And from this information, we could find the joint cost to be allocated to R and T as well. So for R, let's see, for R, what would be it? For R, the joint cost to be allocated will be 720,000. Into for R, the total sales value is 250,000 divided by 800,000, and for T, what would be it? 720,000 into 150,000 divided by 800,000. For R, the cost is equal to 225,000, and for T, it would be 135,000. So we could find the total cost for both. Total cost would be this 225,000 plus 150,000 for R, and for T this 135,000 plus 100,000 separable cost for T. So this total cost for both products can also be found. 225,000 plus 150,000 is equal to 375,000 for R. And for T, it will be 235,000. So are you clear? Okay. Okay, move on to the next question. Question number four. Sony Mart Sawmill manufactures two lumber products from a joint milling process. The two products developed are mine support braces and unseasoned commercial building lumber. A standard production run incurs joint cost of 300,000 and results in 60,000 units of MSB and 90,000 units of CBL. Each MSB sells for $2 per unit and each CBL sells for $4 per unit. So if there are no further processing costs incurred after this pitch-off point, the amount of joint cost allocated to the mine support braces on a relative sales value basis would be. So the two lumber products will be produced after a joint milling process, and these products are mine support braces MSB and commercial building lumber CBL. So the joint cost incurred is 300,000, and after joint cost, 60,000 units of MSB and 90,000 units of CBL will be produced. And at the split-off point, MSB will be selling for 2 per unit and CBL for 4 per unit. And no further processing cost is incurred after the split-off point. So we need to find the joint cost that is allocated to the mine support braces using this relative sales value basis. So the same calculation, our joint cost is joint cost is equal to 300,000, and the two products under consideration is MSB and CBL, and the sales value at split off point for the particular product for MSB is 2 and for CBL it is 4, and the units, how much of the units is produced? For MSB, 60,000 units are produced, and for CBL, 90,000 units are produced. So the total sale, total sales value is going to be 60,000 into 2. Okay. Option A is the right answer. Can't you? 120,000, and for 90,000 into 4 is going to be 90,000 is 4 is going to be 360,000. So the total sales value is 120,000 plus 360,000. It is 480,000. And we need to find the joint cost allocated to mine support braces. For MSB, the joint cost would be, what is the joint cost? 300,000. 300,000 into the sales value of mine support braces 120,000. Divided by total sales value 480,000. So what is the answer? 300,000 into 75,000. Yes, option A is the right answer. Good. Okay. Let's move to the next question. Question number 5. Okay. Altas Foods produces the following three supplemental food products simultaneously through a refining process costing 93,000. And alpha, 10,000 pounds of alpha, popular but relatively rare grain supplement having a caloric value of 4,400 calories per pound. Betters, 5,000 pounds of betters, a flavoring material high in carbohydrates with a caloric value of 11,200 calories per pound. More feed, 1,000 pounds of more feed used as a cattle feed supplement with a caloric value of 1,000 calories per pound. The joint product alpha and betters have a final selling price of $4 per pound and $10 per pound respectively after additional processing cost of $2 per pound of each product are incurred after the split-off point. More feed, a by-product, is sold after the split-off point at $4.03 per pound. Assuming Atlas Foods inventory is more feed and by-product, the joint cost to be allocated to bettors using the weighted quantity method based on caloric value per pound. So we need to be very careful in reading this question. So various informations are provided to us, and three supplemental food products are producing, that is alpha, betters, and more feed. Here, alpha and betas are the main product, and Mofid is a byproduct. It is clearly said in this question, this Mofid is a byproduct. And the final selling price of for alpha is 4 and for betas is 10 after incurring your additional processing cost of 2 per pound. So this is not the sales value at split of point. This is the sales value at after further processing. And this Mofid, the byproduct, is having a sales price of $3 per pound at the split off point. And Altus puts inventories Mofid. This information you need to be very careful. Inventories Mofid. Inventories Mofid means we are using this production method. How we are going to treat the cost and revenues related to byproducts in production method? The estimated NRV of the byproduct is reduced from the joint cost, and that cost is allocated to the main product. So since alpha puts inventories Mofid, they are applying the joint production method for creating the cost and revenue related to byproducts. And we need to find the joint cost to be allocated to betters using this weighted quantity method based on caloric value. Weighted quantity method means we are applying the physical units measure. So first of all, we don't need to consider the sales value at split off point or sales value after further processing, because the method that is asked is the weighted quantity method based on caloric value per pound. Say, for example, take alpha. What is the caloric? 10,000 pounds are produced, and in 10,000 pounds, each pound contains 4,400 of calories. So based on caloric value, we need to allocate cost. So 10,000 into 4,400 would be the total calories present in alpha. That is 4,400,000. So then for betters, how many calories? 5,000 pounds are produced, and each pound contains 11,200 of calories. So which will be 5,000 into 11,200 equals 5 million, sorry, 56 million. $44 million and $56 million. So the total is 44 plus 56 million. So 100 million is the total calories. So we need to allocate this joint cost to this betters based on this physical quantity method. So how much of this joint cost to be allocated? Since Altus puts in inventories Mofid, we need to deduct the net realizable value of the Mofid from the joint cost. What is the NRV of Mofid? We know that the Mofid can be sold at the split of 3 per pound. So how much of Mofid is produced? 1,000 pounds of Mofid produced. So NRV of Mofid is equal to 1,000 pounds into sold at the split of 3. So 3,000 is going to be the NRV of Mofid. So we need to deduct this 3,000 from this joint production cost. What is the joint production cost incurred? 93,000. From that 93,000, we need to deduct this 3,000. So we get 90,000. This 90,000 needs to be allocated to the alpha and betters. So for alpha, for betters, the allocation would be 90,000 into the betters, total calories would be 56 million divided by 100 million. What would be 90,000 into 56 by 100? Into 90,000. 5,400. So option D, 50,400 will be the answer. Are you clear? Since food inventories move feed, we need to detect the NRV of the move feed from the total joint cost to allocate this joint cost to the other main products. So 93,000 minus NRV of move feed is 3,000. We get 90,000. These 90,000 need to be allocated to alpha and betas based on the weighted quantity method, based on caloric value per pound. So we need to calculate the total calories for both products, and we need to allocate this joint cost based on this caloric value. So it's done. The next, let's move forward to the next question. Question number 6. So calculating question number 6, the same information is used. Sorry. Okay. Here the same question of alpha, betas, and mode feed. Let's check the other information. The other informations are the same. The joint products alpha and betas have a final selling price of 4 per pound and $10 per pound respectively. After additional processing cost of $2 per pound for each product are incurred after the split of point. Mode feed, a byproduct, is sold at the split of point as of $3 per pound. Assuming Atlas put inventories mode feed, again production method is used, the byproduct. The joint cost to be allocated to alpha using the physical quantity method. Physical quantity method is used. So we could take these pounds as the physical quantity. Here, no such information like usage of the caloric value provided to us. So we could use this pounds information. And we know that what would be the joint cost to be allocated to joint cost to be allocated would be is equal to 93,000 less the NRV of this mode feed that we calculated in this earlier question, which is 3,000, which equals 90,000, right? And the allocation to alpha, what is the physical quantity for alpha? It is 10,000 pounds, and for betas, it is 5,000 pounds. So the total is equal to 15,000. So for alpha, we need to calculate the joint cost to be allocated to alpha. For alpha, the joint cost to be allocated is 90,000 into 10,000 by 15,000, which is equal to 10 by 15 into 90,000, which is going to be 59,999. Yes, 60,000. Option D is the answer. So is it clear, this question? Okay. Same question, all informations are same, but here no such usage of the caloric values provided to us. So we could just take this pound information, and here mode feed is also inventory, that means production method is used. So we need to deduct the NRV of the mode feed from the joint cost to allocate the remaining joint cost to the main products alpha and betas, and this joint cost allocate to alpha and betas based on their physical unit. So what would be the for betters? Take for betters, what would be it? 90,000 into 5,000 by 15,000. So it would be 30,000. Remaining 30,000 would be allocated to them. And let's move forward to the next question. Question number 7. Company manufactures product X and Y using a joint process The joint processing costs are 10,000. Products X and Y can be sold at split off for 12,000 and 8,000 respectively. After split off, product X is processed further at a cost of $5,000 and sold for 21,000, whereas product Y is sold without further processing. The joint cost allocated to X is. So two products are produced, X and Y, and the joint production cost is provided to us, which is 10,000. And this product X and Y can be sold at the split off point for 12,000 and 8,000. And after split off point, this product X can be further processed, incurring a cost of 5,000, and it will be sold for 21,000. Whereas product Y is sold without further processing, means they are sold at the split off point itself. So what is the joint cost allocated to X? So look at this. One of this product X can be further processed, while product Y cannot be further processed. So either we could use the sales value split off method, or we could use this NRV method, whichever is to us. So under the sales value split off method, what would be this joint cost allocated to X? We need to find the joint cost that is to be allocated to X. First of all, let's check if further processing of this X is profitable or not. So we know that the product X can be sold at for 12,000 at the split off point, and after further processing, it can be sold for 21,000. Right. So what is the incremental revenue? 21,000 minus 12,000, 9,000 would be the incremental revenue. What would be the incremental cost? 5,000. So incremental revenue is greater than incremental cost, whereby we will be having an incremental profit. So it will be profitable to process X further. So either we could use this estimated NRV, or either we could use this relative sales value split off method. So we could apply both method here. So under relative sales value method, so X, their cost is 12,000, and for Y, the cost is 8,000. So total is equal to 20,000. So the joint cost that to be allocated as 10,000. Right. So for X, the cost would be 10,000 into 12,000 by 20,000. And for Y, the cost would be 10,000 into 8,000 by 20,000. So what would be the cost to X? 12 by 20 into 10,000. 6,000 would be the cost to X. Right. So for X, it would be 6,000. For Y, it would be 4,000. So the answer is option B, 6,000. So are you clear? Okay. Yeah, why we are not using this estimate NRV? Because both product X and Y are having a sales value at the split off point. We could use this estimate NRV only in the situation when one of the joint product does not have a sales value at the split off point. So in this particular situation only, we could use this estimated NRV. Here, both product X and product Y is having a sales value at the split off point. And question number 8. So Petrochem Incorporated is a small company that acquires high-grade crude oil from low-volume production wells owned by individuals and small partnerships. The crude oil is processed in a single refinery into 2 oil, 6 oil, and impure distillate. So these are the main products. different products, 2-OIL, 6-OIL, and impure distillates. Petrochem does not have the technology or capacity to process these products further and sells most of its output each month to major refineries. There were no beginning inventories of finished goods or work in process on November 1. The production cost and output of Petrochem for November are as follows. Crude oil acquired and placed in production, 5 million. Direct labor and related cost, 2 million. Factory overhead, 3 million. What are these three costs called? What are these three costs called? So we have crude oil, which is material, direct labor, and factory overhead. That is incurred in the processing of this crude oil. What is these three costs together comprises of? What is this three cost called? Okay, this three cost is together called joint cost. So in the previous question, we are given a joint cost to be a total figure like that. But in here, we are provided with the bifurcations of this components of joint cost, which is material, labor, and factory overhead. So the total joint cost will be 5 million plus 2 million plus 3 million, which is 10 million. And production and sales data for 2-OIL, 6-OIL and distillates are provided to us. And then per unit sales value is also provided to us. The final one-line question that we need to consider is the portion of the joint production cost assigned to 6-OIL based upon physical output would be. Based on the physical output, how much of the joint production cost need to be allocated to 6-OIL? So here physical output method is used, so we do not need to consider any cost related information related to 2-OIL, 6-OIL and distillate products. So the 6-OIL, for 6-OIL we are need to consider. So what is the total joint cost that need to be allocated? Joint cost is equal to 5 million plus 2 million plus 3 million, that is going to be 10 million. And the let's say 6-OIL. So the physical quantity is 300,000 barrels. And for 2-OIL, it is 300,000 barrels. And for 6-OIL, it is 240,000 barrels. And for distillates, it is 120,000 barrels. So the total quantity is 300,000 plus 240,000 plus 120,000 is going to be 660,000. So what would be the joint cost that need to be allocated to 6-OIL? For 6-OIL, the joint cost is equal to 10 million. Into what is the total quantity physical unit for 6-OIL is 240,000 barrels divided by total barrel is 660,000. So the total cost is equal to 10 million into 240,000 divided by 660,000. That is 3636, which is approximated to is provided 3636,000, 3,636,000. So the answer is option B. 3,636,000. So are you clear? Are you clear? Okay, let's move on to the next question. Question number 9. The same question, we use this question alpha, beta, and morphine. Let's take the final one line question. Assuming Atlas Foods does not inventory morphine, the byproduct, the joint cost to be allocated to debtors using the net realizable value method. So here, the Atlas Foods does not inventory morphine. That means they are applying the sales value while computing, while allocating the joint cost, and that joint cost need to be allocated to the main product. No reduction for the NRV of the byproduct needs to be made. And the joint cost need to be allocated based on NRV method, an estimated net realizable value method. So in this paragraph, we have provided information like the joint products alpha and beta, they are having final sales price of 4 per unit and 10 per pound, and respectively after additional processing cost of 2 per pound of each product, and it could have a split-off point, and Mopid is sold at the split-off point for 3 per pound. Let's check. So these three products does not have. So how much of the joint cost need to be allocated? Since sales method is applied, the entire joint cost of 93,000 needs to be allocated to the main product. So how we are going to allocate it? For alpha and betas are our main product, and it is being allocated on the NRV method. Let's check whether there is any sales value or no sales value split off point or not. No, these products does not have any sales value at the split off point, and the final sale price is provided to us 4 per pound, and we need to find the NRV. What is NRV? Future sale price minus any separable cost. So what is future sale price for alpha? It is 4, and the separable cost incurred is 2 per pound, which is 4 minus 2, which is 2, is going to be the NRV. And how much of unit? 2 into 10,000 pounds. So the total sales value is going to be 20,000. And for bettors, the final sales value is 10 per pound minus the additional processing cost incurred as 2 per pound. So 10 minus 2, it is 8. 8 into 5,000 pounds of bettors is produced, which is 40,000. So the total pound sales NRV is going to be 20,000 plus 40,000, 60,000. So we need to allocate the cost to bettors. Bettors, the cost to be allocated is 93,000 into the NRV for bettors is 40,000 divided by total NRV 60,000. So better the joint cost allocation is 93,000 into 40,000 by 60,000, it is 61,999, which is 61,999. Let's check the options. Yes. Oh, their approximate figure is provided to us, 62,000. So option B, 62,000 is our answer. So, are you clear? Okay. The next question number 10. A lumber company produces 2x4s and 4x8 as joint products and sawdust as a byproduct. So, the main product are 2x4s and 4x8s, and the byproduct is sawdust. And the packaged sawdust can be sold for $2 per pound. So the NRV of the sawdust byproduct is $2 per pound. Packaging costs for the sawdust are 0.1 per pound, and sales commissions are 10% of sale price. The byproduct net revenue serves to reduce joint processing cost for joint products. So the byproduct net revenue serves to reduce joint processing cost for joint products. So this information is relating to the application of production method. In production method, the net revenue or the net realizable value of the byproduct will be reduced from the joint processing cost for allocation to joint product. So firm is applying by production method. Joint products are assigned joint cost based on the board feed. So based on board feed, we are assigning the joint cost. So this joint processing cost is 50,000. 2x4, so board feed is 22,100. 4x8, 100,000. Sawdust produced is 1,000 pounds. So here physical quantity is used. So what is the cost assigned to 2x4? What will be the cost assigned to 2x4? We know that how much of the joint cost need to be allocated. Since production method is used, joint cost to be allocated as, but it's a joint processing cost 50,000. We need to deduct the NRV of the, what, the NRV of sawdust. What is the NRV of sawdust? Sawdust is equal to the sales value of sawdust is 2 per pound and the packaging cost is 0.1 per pound. And they incurred a 10% of the sale price. The sale price is 2, 10% of which would be 0.2. So the total NRV is 2 minus 0.1 minus 0.2, which would be 1.7. 1.7 is going to be the NRV of sawdust into 1000 pounds of NRV is used. So into 1700 as the total NRV of sawdust. So we need to deduct these 1700 from the joint cost. So the total joint cost that need to be allocated as 48,300. Right. And we need to allocate this based on the board feet. So for 2x4, take a 2x4 product, the board feet is 200,000. And for 4x8 product, the board feet is 100,000. So total is going to be 300,000. So the joint cost is 48,300. We need to allocate it for 2x4. For 2x4, the board feet is 200,000 divided by total board feet 300,000. So the joint cost allocation is going to be 48,300 into 200,000 divided by 300,000. It is going to be 32,199. Let's sum it up as 4. It is approximate to 32,200. So the answer is option A, 32,200. So are you clear? So next question, question number 11. The primary purpose of allocating common cost to joint product is to determine. Option A, the selling price of byproduct. Option B, the variance between budgeted and actual common cost. Option C, whether or not one of the joint products should be discontinued. Option D, the inventory cost of joint products for financial reporting. The primary purpose for allocating common cost to joint products is to determine. Option A, the selling price of a byproduct. Option B, the variance between budgeted and actual common cost. Option C, whether or not one of the joint products should be discontinued. Option C, the inventory cost of joint products for financial reporting. Option D. Right answer, the inventory cost of joint products for financial reporting. So selling price of a byproduct, because we need to determine the selling price of the byproduct, it is very negligible value. The variance between a budgeted and actual common cost, it's not the answer. Whether or not one of the joint products should be discontinued. So whether making decision making, this joint production cost is irrelevant. So whether or not in deciding whether this joint product should be discontinued or not, the joint production cost does not have any role. So this is not the answer. Option D, the inventory cost of joint products for financial reporting. We need to find the cost of this inventory cost of a particular unit for to be shown in our balance sheet, to be shown in our income statement as part of the financial reporting. We need to determine how much of the total cost is incurred in producing that particular product. And determine the total cost, an allocation of the joint production cost is also necessary along with the separable cost. And move forward to the next question, question number 12. So question number 12. Kilian Company manufactures two skin care lotions, Liquid Skin and Silken Skin, out of a joint process. The joint cost incurred are 420,000 for a standard production run that generates 180,000 gallons of liquid skin and 120,000 gallons of silken skin. Liquid skin sells for 2.4 per gallon and silken skin sells for 3.9 per gallon. If additional processing cost beyond the split of point are 1.4 per gallon for liquid skin and 0.9 per gallon for silken skin, the amount of joint cost of each production run allocated to silken skin on a net realizable value basis is. So the production method that need to be used is the NRV method. And we are provided with the sales value split off method point, like for liquid skin and silken skin. Along with that, further processing cost is also provided to us. 2.4 silken skin, and the further processing cost is also provided to us. Let's find the less and joint cost to be allocated to silken skin based on this NRV. Okay, let's see. For liquid skin, the sale price is 2.4. We need to deduct the further processing cost in order to find the NRV, which is 1.4. So the NRV is going to be 2.4 minus 1.4 is going to be 1. 1. So 1 into how much of this units will be produced? 180 gallons of liquid skin. So the total cost is going to be 180,000. And for silken skin, the sale price is 3.9 less 0.9 of additional processing cost, which provides 3 as the cost. 3 into how much of the 120,000 gallons are produced? 3 into 120,000, 360,000 is the total cost. So the total NRV is going to be 180,000 plus 360,000 is going to be 540,000. So we need to allocate the joint cost to silicon skin. What is the joint cost for 20,000 for silicon skin? For 20,000 into 360,000 is the NRV for silicon skin divided by the total NRV 540,000. So the answer is for 20,000 into 360,000 divided by 540,000. Twenty-seven thousand, 279,999. Twenty-eight thousand, 280,000. Option A, 280,000 is the answer. You clear with the computation? Okay. Question number 13. A company produces products simultaneously through a refining process costing 186,000. The joint products alpha and beta have selling price of $8 and $20 per pound respectively. Omega, a by-product, is sold at a split of 0.46 per pound. The number of pounds produced is shown below. A company produces pounds simultaneously through a refining process that the joint factory cost is 186,000. Alpha and beta are the joint products and have selling price of 8 and 20. And the omega is a by-product and it can be sold at a split of 0.26 per pound. So the production details for alpha, beta, and omega is provided to us. Assuming the company inventories omega. Inventories omega means they are applying the production method. The NRV of the omega will be deducted from the joint production cost, and that remaining joint cost will be allocated to the other remaining main products. The joint cost allocated to alpha using the sales value at split off method. First of all, let's determine how much of this joint cost will be allocated to product. So joint cost is equal to, the joint cost is 186,000. From this we need to deduct the NRV of omega. NRV of omega is equal to, the omega can be sold at the split of cost 6. No such details relating to the cost for omega is provided. So this is the NRV of omega, 6 into 1000. So we get 6000 is the total NRV of omega. We need to deduct that 6000 from the joint production cost. We get 180,000 to be the joint cost. And how we are going to allocate based on the sales value split up. So alpha, the sales value split of us 8 into how much of the unit is produced, 10,000. So the total is 80,000. For beta, the sales value split of is 20 into 5,000 units are produced. So it provides 100,000. So the total is going to be 80,000 plus 100,000. 180,000. So the alpha joint cost to be allocated to alpha is 180,000 of the joint cost into 80,000 divided by 180,000. It is equal to 80,000. So option A, 80,000 is the answer. Is it clear? Okay. Okay, so let's move to the next question. Same question, I think. Let's okay, the same data, but difference is in the application of method. Here, gross market value is used. So, what is gross market value method? It is also called relative sales value split off method or sales value split off method. So, let's do whether there is any sales value split off provided to us. No, alpha and beta, the final sales value is provided to us, which is 4 and 10. So, here, even though it is same as gross market value, we will be applying the NRV method, estimated NRV method. So, and we are provided with information that the excess goods inventory is moved field. That means the NRV of the moved field need to be deducted from the joint production cost, which we calculated earlier as 3 into 1000, 3000 less 93,000 minus 3000, it is 90,000. Okay, so the joint cost that to be allocated as joint cost is equal to 93,000 minus 3,000 of the NRV of 93,000 minus 3,000, it is equal to 90,000 is the joint cost to be allocated to four product alpha and beta based on their and gross market value. And the final selling price is 4 for alpha, and additional processing cost incurred is 2 for 4 minus 2. We get 2 into 10,000, we get 20,000, and for betters is equal to 10 minus 2, which is equal to 8 into 5,000. It is going to be 40,000. So total is 60,000. And For alpha, the cost allocation would be equal to 90,000 into 20,000 divided by 60,000, which is going to be 8. There is a little bit of a mistake. Then it is provided the question that and it incurs no additional processing cost for alpha. So let's avoid this additional processing of two information, because in the question it is asked, we need to assume that it incurs no additional processing cost. So let's avoid this additional processing cost of two. So 4 into 10,000 we get, we don't need to add any additional processing cost. So we could take this as the sales value. 10 into 5,000 is going to be 50,000, and the total is going to be 90,000. And for alpha, it is going to be 40,000 divided by 90,000. So it is going to be 40,000. So the answer is option A. 40,000. So please be careful with the information that there is an information provided in the question that it incurs no additional processing cost for alpha and betas. We need to assume. Here we are provided with the information that there is an additional processing cost of 2. So we need to ignore that information, because the assumption is that no additional processing cost is incurred. So the only NRV that we do take is the 4 and 10 of the sale price, and into their particular quantity we get the total NRV or total sales value. So A. For alpha, that is the joint cost allocation is 90,000 into 40,000 divided by 90,000, which is 40,000. Is it clear? Okay. Let's move to the next question. So, question number 15, a manufacturing company uses a joint production process that produces three products at a split off point, and the joint production cost, the three products are produced, and the joint production cost during April is 720,000, and the production information is provided to us. Three products are R, S, and T. This is the question that we already discussed. So, assume that product P is treated as a byproduct. Here, product P is treated as a byproduct, and that the company accounts for the byproduct at net realizable value as a reduction of joint cost. So it means they are applying the production method, which said that the byproduct at net realizable value as a reduction of joint cost. So we need to reduce the net realizable value of byproduct from the joint cost. Assume also that product S and T must be processed further before they can be sold. What is the total cost of product R in April if joint cost allocation is based on the NRV? So the total cost of R need to be computed. So total cost is equal to joint cost plus separable cost. And if joint cost allocation is based on this, net realizable value is based on the NRV. So we need to check the sales value. For S, there is no sales value split off. And for R, there is a sales value split off at 100. And after further processing cost is 150. So after further processing, it can be sold at 150. So the incremental revenue is $50. And the cost to process is 150,000 for how much unit? 2,500 units. So 150,000 divided by 2,500. So per unit processing cost is 60. So it will not be profitable for the company to process R, because the incremental revenue is 50 and the incremental cost is 60. So incremental revenue is less than incremental cost. So we'll be having loss. So we do not process this product R further. So we could avoid the possibility of processing the product R further. So we could take the sales value at the split off as the sales value for R. But S, there is no choice, because we do not have a sales value split off. So we need compulsorily need to process this product further. So when net NRV method is used, we need to specifically check whether after further processing may be profitable or not. If it is profitable, we could further proceed. If it is not profitable, we could not further proceed. We will sell it at the split off point itself. So, how much of the joint cost need to be allocated? First, we need to find the joint cost to be allocated is equal to the joint cost is 720,000. Since product T is inventoried and production method is applied, we need to deduct the NRV of T from the joint cost. What is the NRV of T? So, the cost NRV of T, after further processing, the T can be sold at 30 into 7,500 will be the total sales value less cost to further process 100,000. So this NRV of T is going to be 125,000. How? Let's take 40, 30 into 7,500 less 100,000, which is 125,000. We need to subtract this 125,000 from 720,000. So we get joint cost to be 595,000. These 595,000 need to be allocated to product R and T. So for R and S, for R, we avoided the possibility of further processing it because further processing will not be profitable. So for R, we take the sales value at split of 100 into 2,500, which is going to be 250,000. And for S, 115 is the cost into 5,000 is the unit produced less cost to further split of is 150,000. So the total NRV is 115 into 5,000 minus 150,000 is going to be 425,000. So the total NRV is going to be 250,000 plus 425,000 is going to be 675,000. And what is the total cost for R? So joint cost to R is equal to the joint cost is 595,000 into R have NRV of 250,000 divided by total NRV 675,000, which is equal to 595,000 into 250,000 divided by 675,000 is going to be 220,370. This is the joint cost for R, and total cost for R equal to this 220,370 less separable cost for R is 150,000, which is 370,370. So this is the question number 50. So 370,370 option C. We should always take units produced instead of units sold. Yes, because the cost is incurred, the further processing cost is incurred for the entire unit produced. So sales may be different. We need to not to take the sales figure because, so sales figure because we need to allocate the joint cost incurred in producing that particular product. In allocating the cost of production, we need to take the unit produced, not the unit sold. Okay. So we have discussed this 15 question from the session. So there's remaining some questions which will include very huge computations and explanations. So our time will not be sufficient. So we'll be discussing the remaining questions on tomorrow. So question number 16 to again a 15 question, more than 15 to 20 questions will be there that we'll be discussing tomorrow. So that's all for today. And is there any doubt related to the questions that we discussed earlier? Okay, please revise to this question, and if there is any doubt, please let me know.
Okay, thank you.